About 10,000 years ago, our ancestors settled down and formed farming societies, basically with the aim to create sustainable food production and enable food security for themselves and their families and their societies. And one thing that they did is start plowing the land and create food innovation at the time. And one of the food innovations that developed was bread. But bread was an accidental discovery. And it was considered such a miracle when bread was discovered that it found its way in religious practices. That's why you have prayers where you say, Lord, give us our daily bread. And in the Middle Ages, bread became synonymous with quality of life because traveling salesmen used to carry two leather pouches on them, one which was for their earnings, the money that they earned, and one for sourdough starter that they carried on them. And wherever they settled down for the night, they were able to create a fresh piece of bread out of that sourdough starter. So bread, beyond being a staple food, it found its way in our daily use and language across different cultures and stands for quality of life. So, example in English, when you say the breadwinner, the person that sustains the quality of life in the household, or in German, in business, you say this is my Brot und Buttergeschäft, so my bread and butter business. It covers the basics. And in French, even, it's interesting. Did you know that the word copain, friend, comes from the Latin root of companis, which means with bread? So bread is beyond just a food item, staple food item, it is synonymous with quality of life, community, and friendship. And now imagine you take this fresh piece of bread. And funnily enough, my talks are always before lunch, so I'm sorry if you feel hungry. So imagine you smell this fresh loaf of bread, and you feel the crust in your fingers, and you hear the crunch as you bite into it. And immediately, it evokes positive memories of family, of good times you had, maybe childhood with family and friends. And being German, bread beyond just being a staple food, it's really important for us Germans. In Germany, we have about 3,200 variations of bread alone. We have bakeries pretty much on every street corner, luring you in with the beautiful smell of fresh bread. And what's interesting is when you meet Germans that live abroad because they're as expats, bread will become a topic at some point in conversation. They will probably start baking it at home, or they will, when they go home to visit friends and family back in Germany, they will just carry a suitcase full of fresh bread from home, so it lasts for a while, typically German. So when we heard that the German astronaut Alexander Gerst was going to fly to the International Space Station, and of course he spent 6 months on average, he actually stayed 8 months up there, and so we thought, wouldn't it be great if we built him an oven that would allow him to experience that happiness of having a fresh piece of bread that he could bite into and feel connected with Earth? And when we thought more about this project, this was the start of Bacon Space, but when we thought more about the project, we realized that actually it's not just about making one German astronaut happy. It's about, there's probably more here. It's not just the one German astronaut, but maybe we have a tool here, a stepping stone that allows us to go further into space, to allow us to perform human exploration and allow humans to go further. So just imagine this situation. You're in your space tin, you're looking out into the through the window at the distance of your home planet. It's just a tiny speck of blue, like that little star there in the picture. And wouldn't it be amazing? You prepare yourself a fresh loaf of bread and you feel instantly connected the moment you bite into it with home. Now, the reality is more like this. So, and this doesn't really connect you back to home. Most space food is really dehydrated or canned. It's very expensive to get it up into space. And so beyond being just a cost problem, imagine feeding a crew traveling to Mars and the journey takes about 1.5 years there and back. Now, how would we enable sustainable food production sustainably to feed them on their way to Mars? Do we send food parcels with cargo ships that follows their ship? Probably we'll never reach them in time. Do we have food islands dotted around between Mars and Earth, the kind of orbiting those two planets, and they just replenish their supplies? Or do they carry everything with them? And we did a calculation, roughly, if you send a crew of seven people to Mars, and you wanted to feed each one a fresh bread roll per day, you're looking at about 4 tons of flour alone that you need to carry with you, which is really unsustainable. I guess you agree. So what we thought about with Bake in Space is really how to create this value chain from growing grain to baking bread. And we devised a five-step plan that would basically allow us to grow crops, harvest the grains, grind them down to flour, knead it to dough, and then bake the dough into a fresh bread roll. And our goal was to start at the end of it, so that's why phase one is actually on this side, because first we want to understand what we want to bake and how to achieve that before we then start looking at what ingredients we need and what processes are necessary to achieve that. Because baking is really hard in space. This is the concept prototype oven that we've developed, and we realized quickly that there's many technical challenges that would need to be overcome. So one issue is crumbs, because crumbs are actually lethal in space, not only for machinery, it can get into machines, but it can also get into the lungs of the astronaut, it can get into the eyes, and there's not a doctor that you can immediately ask for help. Fire is an issue, so we have to create an oven that is completely separate from all the other machinery, so it doesn't affect any other machines or the space module. So if fire occurs, all the exposed surfaces, any surface that the astronaut is able to touch, is not allowed to be hotter than 45 degrees because the astronaut can get burnt on it. And we only have 250 watts of power available, which is 1/10 of what you have here on Earth, which basically requires a lot of insulation to enable us to achieve a baking temperature of 220 degrees inside the oven. And then there's the issue of the baking procedure. Here on Earth, you would basically preheat the oven, open it, put something inside, and bake it. This is not possible in space because we have the risk, A, the open oven door, of course, is an exposed surface that the astronaut can touch. But the other thing is, if we leave the door open, there's the risk that the hot air bubble can escape the oven in one piece, and air doesn't automatically mix with the surrounding air. So you have an invisible hot 200-degree air bubble just sitting in the space station, and an astronaut flying through it will seriously get burned. So what we need to do is to recreate the baking procedure, and that implies that we have a cold oven. We put our dough inside, we heat it up, we bake it, and then cool down to below 45 degrees, which means that it takes a lot longer to bake something in microgravity. On top of that, the whole oven is controlled from ground, so we do it from Earth. It's kitted out with different sensors. We even have a camera. We had requests for live streams directly from the inside of the oven. I don't know why, but... So we would basically be operating the oven remotely from Earth, and then tell the astronaut that it's ready, and then he will test if we have achieved our goal. So as I said, it's going to be a lot longer in the oven, which means that, adding to the complexity, how do you make it crumb-free? Because things are going to start drying out in the oven if it's for such a long time in there. So the challenge is to find the right amounts of water steam that you add to the baking chamber inside the baking process that will enable you to finally have a freshly baked, crumb-free bread roll. Yeah, this is the baking part, but the other technology demonstrations are equally as difficult. So, for example, mixing flour with water to create dough. So you have two different materials there that just don't talk to each other. One being flour, which like crumbs, basically explodes in all directions. Water, which stays basically in one ball of water due to surface tension. And when you mix them, what you'll get is a ball of water with flour stuck on the outside of it, which does not really taste that great. So how do you create dough in this complex environment? So you really have to create new ways how to mix these two materials so that they achieve the goal of becoming dough and eventually to be able to bake them. So you might agree with me that actually baking is rocket science in space. But I'm not a rocket scientist, and I'm neither a trained scientist nor an engineer. But somehow I ended up in this industry. And like many people, I felt inspired by space. I watched Star Trek and Star Wars. And until about 16 years, I never thought I'd ever end up in this sector contributing to its evolution. And to be able to solve a tiny piece of the puzzle by hopefully improving the quality of life of astronauts in space. But if you think about it, we're getting more people on this planet, and our supplies are kind of reaching its end. And to me, it's inevitable that humanity will find its way to become a multiplanetary species at some point. And the reality is that it's not rocket science that we need, not rocket scientists that we need to go out there and create this future of becoming a multiplanetary species. But it's companies and teams that work in different domains that can contribute to the evolution of going forward in this direction. And also people like yourselves that might have special skills that you can contribute to enabling us to reach that future. So 10,000 years after our ancestors have settled down to create civilization on Earth, now is the time to pave the way for civilization in space. And I'm trying to bake bread, and now it's your turn. What can you offer? Thank you.